This is Lecture 6, Spurious, Additive, and Interactive Relationships. By the end of this lecture, you should be able to understand the importance of control variables in statistical analysis, be familiar with spurious, additive, and interactive relationships, construct and interpret a controlled cross-tabulation table, and construct and interpret a controlled line graph. In the previous lecture, I showed you how to use cross-tabulations to analyze the relationship between two nominal or ordinal level variables. I used the following hypothesis as an example. Women are more likely than men to be Democrats. I presented you with this hypothetical data and showed you how to arrange the data in a cross-tabulation table to analyze the relationship between the independent variable, gender, and the dependent variable, party identification. I also showed you that you were supposed to compare values within each row to determine if there was a statistical relationship between the independent and dependent variable. So in this case, just examining the Democrat row, 75% of women were Democrats, while only 33.33% of men were Democrats. This demonstrates that women are more likely than men to be Democrats. However, our analysis cannot stop here. Just because two variables are statistically related does not mean they are causally related, meaning that it does not necessarily mean that variations in the independent variable cause variations in the dependent variable. There could be other reasons why we see a statistical relationship between two variables. What else can explain these results? One explanation is that the relationship between the two variables is spurious. A spurious relationship occurs when there seems to be a statistical relationship between an independent and dependent variable, but that is only because the independent variable is related to the true causal variable. When that happens, variations in the independent variable are similar to variations in the true causal variable. This makes it appear that variations in the independent variable cause variations in the dependent variable, but really it is variations in the true causal variable that are causing variations in the dependent variable. For example, I previously argued that gender influenced party identification. However, while more women may be Democrats, that may be due to a large percentage of women being low income. Income influences party identification, not gender. If this is true, poor women and poor men should be equally as likely to be Democrats. Rich men and rich women should be equally as likely to be Republicans. In order to assess whether there is a spurious relationship between gender and party identification, we can use a controlled cross-tabulation. In a controlled cross-tabulation, we can determine that, after controlling for income, whether women are more likely than men to be Democrats. Here is data from a hypothetical survey where respondents were asked about their party identification, their gender, and their income. In order to arrange this data in a controlled cross-tabulation, you place the dependent variable name in the first column heading. Then you place the category names of the dependent variable in the rows underneath. So in this case, you place the title party identification in the first column heading, since it's the name of the dependent variable. And you place the terms Democrat and Republican underneath it. Then you put a total row underneath it. Next, you create two subtables, one for each category of the control variable. It is very important that you know which of your variables is your control variable. In this case, our control variable was income. And as you can see from the previous slide, the categories are low and high. So you can create a low income subtable and a high income subtable. Next, within each subtable, you place the category names of the main independent variable. So in this case, gender was our main independent variable, and the category names were male and female. So I place male and female in the low income subtable and in the high income subtable. Next, we have to go through our data to see how many cases fit the criteria for each cell. So we should go through and look for all the low-income male Democrats here and here for two. Then we would look for the low-income female Democrats here, here, and here for 3. We continue this process until all the cells were filled. Then we calculate the column totals at the bottom. So in the first column, for example, the calculation is 2 plus 0, which equals 2. Then we calculate cell percentages. The cell percentage calculation is the cell total divided by the column total, and that value multiplied by 100. So in this first cell, the calculation is 2 divided by 2, and that value times 100 for 100%. In the second cell, the calculation is 0 divided by 2, and that value times 100 for 0%. And in the third cell, the calculation is 2 divided by 2, and that value times 100 or 100%. And then you continue this process for the rest of the cells. This is the original cross-tabulation. As you can see, women were more likely than men to be Democrats. 75% of women were Democrats, while only 33% of men were Democrats. Here's the new controlled cross-tabulation. To interpret this table, you compare across the rows in each subtable. So in the low-income subtable, you compare the male and female category percentages for Democrats. So as you can see, 100% of low-income males and 100% of low-income females were Democrats. So low-income men and women were both equally as likely to be Democrats as the percentages are the same. Now look at the high-income subtable. You compare the male and female's category percentages for Democrats. As you can see, 0% of high-income males and 0% of high-income females were Democrats. So high-income men and women were both equally as likely to be Democrats, as the percentages are the same. Since it seems like both men and women were equally as likely to be Democrats in this table, that implies that gender has no effect on party identification whatsoever. What this table does show us is that it is income that has an effect on party identification. 100% of low-income individuals were Democrats, while 0% of high-income individuals were Democrats. So the conclusion of this analysis is, after controlling for income, the differences in the percentages between men and women disappear. Men and women are equally as likely to be Democrats. However, it does appear that low-income voters are more likely to vote for Democrats than high-income voters. So for future reference, if you're examining a controlled cross-tabulation table, this is the decision rule for determining whether the relationship between your main independent variable and your dependent variable is spurious. If within each subtable of the control variable, when comparing percentages between rows, the percentages between the main independent variable subcategories are the same, but when comparing the percentages between the subtables, the percentages between the subtables are different, the relationship between the main independent variable and dependent variable is spurious. Controlled cross-tabulations can also show us whether two different variables both independently affected a dependent variable. Consider the following hypotheses. Income and gender both have independent effects on party identification. Poorer individuals tend to vote for Democrats, and women are generally more likely to vote for Democrats than men. In these hypotheses, we expect both gender and income to influence party identification. Imagine that we conducted a survey where we asked respondents their party identification, their gender, and their income. Then we created this controlled cross-tabulation table to determine if gender and income influences party identification. To interpret this table, you compare across the rows in each subtable. So in the low-income subtable, you compare the male and female category percentages for Democrats. As you can see, 40% of low-income males and 60% of low-income females were Democrats. So low-income women are more likely than low-income men to be Democrats. Now look at the high-income subtable. You compare the male and female category percentages for Democrats. As you can see, 20% of high-income males and 40% of high-income females were Democrats. So high-income women are more likely than high-income men to be Democrats. In addition, it is clear that more low-income individuals were Democrats than high-income individuals were. Between 40 and 60% of low-income individuals were Democrats, whereas only between 20 and 40% of high-income individuals were Democrats. Clearly, income has an effect on party identification as well. Clearly, women are more likely than men to be Democrats. In addition, it is clear that overall, more low-income individuals were Democrat than high-income individuals were. But in order for gender and income to both independently have an effect on party identification, the effect of gender on party identification has to be the same for low-income individuals and high-income individuals. To determine this, you calculate the effect of the main independent variable, in this case gender, in both subtables. You first find the differences between the male and female percentages for Democrats in the low-income subtable. In this case, 60% of women and 40% of men were Democrats. So 60 minus 40% is 20%. Next, you find the difference between the male and female percentages for Democrats in the high-income subtable. In this case, 40% of women and 20% of men were Democrats. So 40 minus 20% is 20%. Since the effect of gender is the same in both subtables, the effect of gender and income on party identification are independent from one another. So the conclusion you can draw from this cross-tabulation is, both income and gender influence party identifications. Their effects on the dependent variable are independent of each other. Women are more likely than men to be Democrats, and high-income voters are more likely to vote for Democrats than low-income voters. So for the future reference, if you're examining a controlled cross-tabulation table, this is the decision rule for determining whether the relationship between your independent variables and your dependent variable is independent additive. If within each subtable of the control variable, when comparing percentages across rows, the percentages between the main independent variable categories differ, the main independent variable has an effect on the dependent variable. And if the effect is the same between the subtables, and if the control variable also has an effect on the dependent variable, the relationship is additive. Controlled cross-tabulations can also show us whether the effect of one independent variable on a dependent variable is conditional upon another variable. Consider the following hypotheses. The effect of gender on the probability that a person votes for a Democrat depends on their income. While most low-income individuals vote for Democrats regardless of gender, high-income women are more likely than high-income men to vote for Democrats. Imagine that we conducted a survey where we asked respondents their party identification, their gender, and their income. Then we created this controlled cross-tabulation table to determine if gender and income influence party identification. To interpret this table, you compare across the rows in each subtable. So in the low-income subtable, you can compare the male and female subcategories for Democrats. As you can see, 40% of low-income males and 50% of low-income females were Democrats. So low-income women are more likely than low-income men to be Democrats. Now look at the high-income subtable. You compare the male and female category percentages for Democrats. As you can see, 20% of high-income males and 40% of high-income females were Democrats. So high-income women are more likely than high-income men to be Democrats. In addition, it is clear that more low-income individuals were Democrats than high-income individuals. Between 40% and 50% of low-income individuals were Democrats, whereas only between 20 and 40% of high-income individuals were Democrats. Clearly, income has an effect on party identification. Clearly, women are more likely than men to be Democrats. In addition, it is clear that overall, more low-income individuals were Democrats than high-income individuals were. But in order for gender and income to both have an interactive effect on party identification, the effect of gender on party identification has to be different for low-income individuals and high-income individuals. To determine this, you calculate the effect of the main independent variable, in this case gender, in both subtables. You first find the differences between the male and female percentages for Democrats in the low-income subtable. In this case, 50% of women and 40% of men were Democrats, so 50% minus 40% is 10%. Next, you find the difference between the male and female percentages for Democrats in the high-income subtable. In this case, 40% of women and 20% of men were Democrats. So 40% minus 20% is 20%. Since the effect of gender is greater for high-income individuals than low-income individuals, the effect of gender and income on party identification is interactive. So the conclusion is, The effect of gender on the probability that a person votes for a Democrat depends on their income. While most low-income individuals vote for Democrats regardless of gender, high-income women are more likely than high-income men to vote for Democrats. So the decision rule determines if there's an interactive relationship between two independent variables and a dependent variable is as follows. If within each subtable of the control variable, when comparing the percentages across rows, the percentages between the main independent variable subcategories differ, in at least one subtable, the main independent variable has effect on the dependent variable. And if the effect of the main independent variable is different between the two subtables, the relationship is interactive. You can also use graphs to illustrate spurious, additive, and interactive relationships between variables. Remember that when you make a graph between one independent variable and a dependent variable, you can place the dependent variable name on the y-axis, the independent variable name on the x-axis, you put the correct quantitative labels on the axes, and then you draw the relationship between the variables. This is what a positive relationship should look like. When you're drawing the relationship between two independent variables and a dependent variable, you place the dependent variable on the y-axis and the main independent variable on the x-axis. Then you draw a line for each of the categories of the control variable. So for example, if you were to draw the relationship between gender and party identification while controlling for income, you would put party identification on the y-axis. I assume Democrat equals 1 and Republican equals 0. Gender on the x-axis, and then draw the relationship between gender and party identification for both low and high income voters. As you can see in this graph, blue indicates low income and green indicates high income. What this graph suggests is that there is a spurious relationship between gender and party identification. Gender has no effect on party identification. Both men and women are both equally as likely to be Democrats, the one category on the y-axis, and equally as likely to be Republicans, the zero category on the y-axis. Or in other words, as gender changes, party identification stays the same. However, what this graph does tell us is that income does have an effect on party identification. Low-income voters, the blue line, are more likely to be Democrats, the one category on the y-axis, than high-income voters, the green line. Now imagine that there's an independent additive relationship between gender, income, and party identification. If that were the case, the graph would look like this. As you can see, women are more likely than men to identify as Democrats. As gender moves to female, the probability of identifying as a Democrat increases. In addition, low-income voters, the blue line, were more likely to identify as Democrats than high-income voters, the green line. And since the lines are parallel to each other, that implies that the slope of the lines are the same. Or in other words, it implies that the effect of gender on party identification is the same for both low and high-income voters. Now imagine that there is an interactive relationship between gender, income, and party identification. If that were the case, the graph would look something like this. In this graph, gender has no effect on party identification for low-income voters, the blue line. As gender changes, party identification stays the same. It stays at the Democrat value of 1. However, gender has an effect on party identification for high-income voters, the green line. High-income women were more likely to vote for Democrats than high-income men. So the effect of gender on party identification depends on income, suggesting that there is an interactive relationship between gender and income and party identification. There are lots of different types of interactive relationships. Figure 4.9 from your textbook shows you more types of interactive relationships.